गुड इवनिंग एमा। गुड इवनिंग वंशिका। सो आई एम राहुल सहा एंड टुडे वी विल बी बिगिनिंग अ न्यू टॉपिक, अ न्यू चैप्टर। गुड इवनिंग आत्मा। दिस इज द सेक्सुअल रिप्रोडक्शन इन द फ्लावरिंग प्लांट्स, राइट? दिस इज चैप्टर नंबर टू एंड ऑलमोस्ट द लास्ट चैप्टर एज पर द कोर्स। एंड देयर इज ऑल्सो specific rumor that your course may also be further reduced by 25% more, and thereby you will be only left with, you can say, 50% of the course at the end of the 10 year for your board examination, right? So we all know that if you begin with, so a flower arising on the axil of a bract, okay, a flower arising, and say, in the axil of a bract, you might have read this also, it is known as bractate flower, right? And if the bract is absent, in many cases the bract has been found to be absent, okay, then the flower is known to be or is referred to be as E-bractate. E-bractate, right? Now the stalk of a flower, what do you call the stalk of a flower? The stalk of a flower is specifically known by the name as pedicel. Okay, pedicel. And if the pedicel is supposed to be absent, okay, if the pedicel is also absent, then it is known as a sessile, sessile, you can say, flower. So this is what it is known as, and in some cases what happens is, there is a very short pedicel present. The pedicel is too short to call it a complete pedicel. So that time, such a flower is described to be a subsessile flower. A subsessile flower, if it has too short pedicel, a very, very short pedicel. Okay. So these are the characteristics. In some flowers also, two small leaf-like structures are also present on the pedicel. There are some small leaf-like structures which are present. Which are present on the pedicel. Okay. Those specific structures are known as bracteoles. Okay, so you might have studied this in class 11th. I am just revising it for you. And the flower is known as bracteolate. If you have studied the morphology of the plants, flowering plants in detail, you must be knowing about all this. I am just going for a quick revision before we begin the chapter. Okay. So if bracteolates are absent, again it is known as a bracteolate. Is absent, then again it is known as E-bractulate. So these are the questions which can be asked in any board exam or NEET exam, one mark question. Okay, from this chapter and also from the class 11 chapter, that is the morphology of flowering plants. Okay, and the pedicel can also have some variations. Okay, the pedicel, which has an upper swollen portion, if it has an upper swollen portion, then it's known as thalamus or torus. Thalamus or torus. Okay. It's also known by the name receptacle. Okay. Receptacle. Now, what happens is this thalamus is mostly considered, okay, to act as an or as an axis of the flower. Okay, so it bears four types of floral leaves, arranged in successive whorls. Okay, so the thalamus bears four types of floral leaves arranged in successive whorls, known as, you can say, sepals, then petals, then stamen and carpel. Okay. So these are the names by which it is known as. So collectively, or if you say cumulatively, these whorls are also known as calyx, okay, then corolla, then androecium, male part, and the gynoecium, female part. Okay. So we are all aware of this. I'm just going through the revision part. Okay. So again, a flower is the branch of the stem. If you see what the flower is, so for the revision, a flower is a branch of a stem only, which is specially modified for one purpose, that is sexual reproduction. Okay. So the sexual reproductive organs only are known by the name as androecium and gynoecium. Okay, so the stamens and carpels, it represents the male and female sex organs. We are all aware of it respectively. And calyx and corolla, they do not really take part in sexual reproduction. Okay, and thus they represent, or thus they are known as the non-essential part of a flower. Okay, specifically calyx and corolla. Now, if you talk about the smallest flower which comes in your NEET examination, which is the smallest flower, okay, it occurs in a specific plant known as Wolffia microscopia. Okay. While the largest flower is that of Rafflesia. The largest flower, and the national flower of India, we are all aware of it, is lotus, that is Nelumbium genus. Okay, Nelumbium species, then we can call it. Then the axis on which the flower develops is known as a peduncle or mother axis, the axis on which the flower develops. So it really represents, if you see anterior side and posterior side, getting, so it represents the posterior side. Okay, now coming on to what are complete flowers. Okay, complete flowers, perfect flowers. So a flower like, you can say, brassica, or you can say even this one, petunia, they contain all the floral parts, that is calyx, they contain corolla, okay, then they contain androecium, they do contain gynoecium, then they are said to be a very, very complete plant. If any one hole is absent in a flower, okay, if any one hole, if any word is absent, if any one word is supposed to be absent in a flower, then it is known to be an absent flower. Sorry, you can say incomplete flower. It can, you can call it an incomplete flower. So the absence of any one whorl can cause it to become a, or become an incomplete flower. So the thing is, again, the flower which possesses both the essential organs is known as perfect or bisexual or hermaphrodite. If both the essential organs means both the androecium and gynoecium. And if any one of the two reproductive organs is missing in the flower, it is described to be as imperfect. If it is a unisexual, it is described to be as imperfect / unisexual. So unisexual flowers are imperfect in nature. They are categorized as being imperfect. And when it comes to a unisexual flower, if I talk about a unisexual flower, okay, so if carpels are absent, it is termed as male flower or staminate flower. If carpels are absent, it is known as a male flower. If only stamens are there, so staminate flower. Okay, and when stamens are absent, you can say the flower is female or pistillate. Flower is called as female flower or pistillate flower. Okay. Pistillate flower. Sometimes what happens is both the essential whorls are absent in the flower. So such a flower is also present, that is known as a neuter. Like some flowers in case of sunflower. Okay, the flowers are meant for only attracting the insects for various kinds of pollination. Okay, now I'll tell you again some of the descriptive terms which are asked in the NEET examination regarding the flowers. Number one is cruciform. Okay, cruciform. Good evening, Tarun. So cruciform flower. Okay, the presence of 4 free, and write the definition, presence of 4 free unguiculate petals. Unguiculate petals arranged in the form of a cross. Arranged in the form of a cross, okay, is known as, you can say, cruciform pattern, and the example is specifically the brassica plant. So each uniguiculate petal consists of a, you can say, a lower narrow portion known as a claw, lower narrow portion known as a claw, and the upper broad portion, it is known as the limb. So this is a neat question regarding the botany, okay, from the botanical, you can say, part. Then we have something known as another terminology. We have caryophyllaceous. Okay. Caryophyllaceous. Now these are what? There are 5 uniguiculate. There are 5, or you can say unguiculate. Unguiculate petals. Okay. In the cruciform one, we had 4 unguiculate petals. In the caryophyllaceous, we have 5 unguiculate petals. That's the main portion where it is getting demarcated from being a cruciform, right? So then we have rosaceous. Number 3 is rosaceous. When we talk about rosaceous, the petals are 5 or even more than 5, having very reduced. The number of petals can be 5 or more than 5. Okay, depending upon they could be having very reduced or sessile claw. Okay, reduced or sessile claw. Claw is the lower narrow portion. Okay, the petal may consist of a lower narrow portion, which I just described to you in the cruciform section. So, reduced or sessile claw that it could be having. And you could be having also a large broad limb that could also be present. Okay, so best example is rose here. We are all aware and have seen the specific flower of rose. Okay. Then next one is, you have something known as papilionaceous. Okay. Papilionaceous. Just like you had caryophyllaceous, you have papilionaceous. What happens is, it is a butterfly shaped, or it contains a butterfly shaped, okay, irregular corolla, which consists of 5 petals. Now the posterior petal is the largest node, largest known petal. The posterior petal is the largest known petal. Okay, which is known as the standard or vexillum also. So it's a tough, neat question. Vexillum, they can be asked. Vexillium belongs to papilionaceous. Okay, the posterior petal, not the anterior, the posterior petal is known as the vexillum. Okay, now 2 lateral petals are small and free. They are known as, again, lateral petals. Again, neat question. They are known as wings or alae. Okay, just note it down. Then we have polyandrous. Okay. So if you know about these things, then you have a good probability of solving a lot of neat questions from this chapter and also from morphology of flowering plants chapter in class 11. So polyandrous means, you might be knowing that all the stamens are free in the androecium. All the stamens are free in the androecium. Okay, again, good example is Brassica only. Then we can talk about epipetalous. Epipetalous. Here, filaments of the stamens. Filaments of the stamens. They adnate with petals, or they come with petals. Okay, of the stamens. Adnate with petals. Okay. So it is found mostly in the gametophyllous corolla, like of brinjal, petunia, okay, these kinds of specific plants. Then you have epicepalous. Okay. What does this mean? This means that the stamens are always attached with sepals. The stamens are always attached with sepals. Okay. Now next will be Gynandrous. If I talk about Gynandrous, okay, that means when the anther of stamen, they are united with stigma of carpel. When the anthers of stamen, stamens are united with the stigma of carpel. Stigma of carpels, then it forms something known as gynostegium. Gynostegium. Okay, so that is known as gynandrous. Then we can come to inserted. Inserted means what? When the stamens are shorter than the corolla tube. When the stamens are shorter than the corolla tube. Okay, and forms the, or you can say it remains, okay, it remains mostly hidden inside. It remains concealed, hidden inside. That is the meaning of inserted. It remains inserted, right? It doesn't really show off, doesn't really reveal itself. Now, exerted. Another one is the exerted one. Exerted means when, this is the opposite of inserted, when the stamens come out from corolla tube and show off. When the stamens come out from the corolla tube. Okay, that is the meaning of being exerted. Okay, then we have something known as didynamous. Okay, didynamous. What happens here is, there are four stamens, out of which two stamens are larger and two stamens are shorter in length. There is a presence of four stamens. Two are longer in length and two are shorter in length. That is known as didynamous. Okay. Now you have tetradynamous. Tetradynamous, next one. Tetradynamous means what? There are six stamens in which four stamens are large, tetra. Okay, dynamous means that four stamens are large, dynamous is large and two are short. So there are six stamens, since it is tetradynamous means four stamens are large, longer, two are shorter. Okay. Then you have alternately petalous, next one. Alternately petalous. This can all be asked in your NEET examination. So this is a single whorl of stamens. There is only a single whorl of stamens. Okay, the number of stamens is equal to the number of petals, always remember, and they alternate with the petal lobes. The number of stamens is equal to the number of petals, that is true, and they also alternate with the petal lobes. Okay, then you have antipetalous. After alternate petalous, you have एंटी फेटाइल। सो अगेन इट विल बी ऑलमोस्ट द सेम बट द स्टैमेंस आर प्रेजेंट अपोजिट टू द पेटल लोब्स, मींस यू विल बी हैविंग नंबर ऑफ स्टैमेंस व्हिच इज इक्वल टू द नंबर ऑफ पेटल्स, दैट विल बी सेम, बट द ओनली डिफरेंस इज हियर द स्टैमेंस एग्जिस्ट, you can say opposite to the petal lobe, to the petal lobe. Okay, then next is what you have is known as diplostomonas. In diplostomonas, what happens is the stamens are double the number of petals. Diplo, double. The stamens are double the number of petals. Okay. That is the correct thing. And also are present in two whorls. So the outer world of stamens is alternating, means does always alternate with petals. Okay, that is alterni petalis also you can call it. While the inner world is opposite to that of petals, that is the antipetalis. That is why it is diplo. It is a combination of alterni petalis and antipetalis. Okay, making it diplostomonas. Okay, then we have obdiplostomonas. After diplo, obdiplo. Obdiplostomonas. Okay. Here it is why. It is why it is known as obdiplo, means because it's the reverse of diplostomonas. The outer world here of stamens is opposite to petals. Okay, that is antipetalous. There the outer world was alternating with the petals, it was alterni. Inner was anti. Here the outer one is the, you can say, antipetalous, and the inner wall of stamens is alternating with the petals. So the inner world is known as alterni petalous, whereas alterni petalous was the outer wall in the case of diplostomonas. You can call them diplostomonas, but here that is obdiplostomonas. So here this is just the opposite case, the other way around compared to diplostomonas. Okay, then we have isostomonas. Isostomonas means all the stamens in a flower. Iso means same, are alike in shape. All the stamens in a flower specifically are alike in shape, not only shape but size and mode of dehiscence. Could be more, but these are the main things: mode of dehiscence and can write here, etc. Okay, that is iso, like isochoric process, isobaric process, isothermal process. You might have studied in the thermodynamics. Okay, now next is, you have heterostomonas. Okay, means the stamens in a flower, they differ in their state. Hetero means not same, so just opposite of iso. The stamens in the flower, okay, they differ in their shape. Their shape, then their size and mode of dehiscence. Etc. Then we have adelphous.
Ok,
Adelphus. Here the stamens are fused by their filaments. The stamens are fused by their filaments. But there is a catch. The stamens are fused. By their filaments. That is true. But the anthers are free. But the anthers are completely free. Okay. So now what happens is if the filaments. Okay. Of. If the filaments of all the stamens are fused to form one group, it is termed as monoadelphus. Monoadelphus. Okay, one group after fusion it should form, or it should give you one group only. It will be known as monoadelphus. Okay, the best example here is the one that we use for pollination experiment, that is Hibiscus rosa sinensis. But when they are fused to form, you can say two groups, that is known as diadelphus. Diadelphus. Okay. And when sometimes what happens is when they fuse to form more than two groups, it is known as polyadelphus. That can also happen. Polyadelphus. These are all the things that can happen, right? Then we have syngenesis. You can say syngenesis, or it is known as synanthrous also. Synanthrous. So what happens is, in this case, what will happen? The filament of stamens are free. Okay. The filaments of stamens are completely free. Okay, that is the first part, are free. And but what happens is the anthers are fused by their sites. Anthers are fused by their, you can say, sites. Anthers are fused by their sites to form a ring around the style. Best example is sunflower. Around the style. Okay. Best example again here is the sunflower. Next is, if I talk about synandrous. Synanthrous is done, and now synandrous. So when both filaments and anthers of the stamens are completely fused. Okay, completely fused. That time they are known as synandrous. Okay. Then next one will be your apocarpus. You have apoenzyme, here it is apocarpus. Okay. Inactive enzyme that is, but this one is different. There are two or more carpels here. Okay. In the gynecium, which are free, completely free from each other. There are two or more carpels in the gynoecium which are completely free from one another. It is known as apocarpus. Okay, or each other you can say. Then we have syncarpus. Now if we talk about syncarpus, okay, syncarpus is two or more carpels which are fused to form a single compound ovary. When two or more carpels are fused to form a single compound ovary. Okay, that is the meaning of syncarpus, like petunia. You might have worked with petunia in the lab. Okay, last year you might have worked with it in class 11. This year the schools are closed, so that is known as complete, you can say, syncarpus. Okay, so these information what I have given you right now will be very, very significant once you talk about or once you think about clearing NEET examination. Okay, so they will be asking about these things, so do keep these things in your mind. So now we will be talking about the microsporangium. Before I talk about the microsporangium, I'll give you a brief structure of the stamen and anther both. Okay, so the stamen, if you talk about the stamen, okay, what happens is, stamen in a flower, it consists of what? It consists of two part, the long and narrow stalk like filament, okay, and the upper border knob like bilobed anther, two lobes, bilobed anther. Okay, so if we draw like this, okay, simply if you draw, so what can you do is, you can draw like this, and two anthers can be drawn like this here. So this is the connective, you can say. This is the filament. This is the anther, bilobed anther, right? So what happens is, the proximal end of the filament, it is attached to the thalamus or petal of the flower. Proximal means the closer end, right? And the number and length of the stamen, they all vary in various species. Now, once we talk about anther, okay, our main focus is the anther here, okay. What happens is, a normal bithecus, or I can call it dithecus, two-lobed anther, is made up of two anther lobes. So I can call it bithecus or dithecus, okay. For your convenience, you can call it bi or di, both, two lobes here normally. Now, two anther lobes will contain what? It will contain four elongated cavities, okay, which can contain pollen sacs or microsporangia. One pollen sac is known as microsporangium. Okay, microsporangium. Then we will learn about microsporogenesis, then megasporogenesis, then we will be learning about the double fertilization event, right? So that is how the things will pan out. Okay, so the thing is, that is structure of, you can say, anther and what is called stamen. Now if we talk about the microsporangium, okay, I'll just open a microsporangium page for you so that the things are pretty clear. Microsporangium, pollen sac. Just look at this image, a very good image. This will be a good image too. So we have ovary, anther, petal, sepal, you can see all this. Then look at this image, this is a good image. Okay. So once we talk about microsporangium, okay, so in detail or simply the pollen sac, so what happens is, young anther, while it is still in flower bud, okay, mostly we take the transverse section, means we cut like this, transverse section, okay. So what happens is, it reveals the presence of outermost epidermis. So the outermost wall here, if you look at the outermost wall, if you look at this image, ओके, लाइंग जस्ट बिलो द एपिडर्मिस इज नोन एज समथिंग विल बी गिवन एज एंडोथीसियम. ओके, आई कैन यू कैन सी हियर एंडोथीसियम हियर, इट इज नोन एज एंडोथीसियम और द फाइब्रस लेयर. ओके, बिकॉज यू कैन सी द वॉल और टू रेडियल एंड इनर, देर आर टू रेडियल एंड वन इनर वॉल्स आर प्रेजेंट, यू कैन सी हियर, दे डेवलप इन टू फाइब्रस थिकनिंग्स ऑन देम एक्सेप्ट एट द जंक्शंस, एक्सेप्ट एट द जंक्शंस ऑफ द टू पोलन सैक्स. ओके, नाउ बिलो द एंडोथीसियम देर आर यू कैन से वन टू थ्री लेयर्स. ओके, यू कैन सी हियर वन टू थ्री लेयर्स, हियर वन लेयर इज ओनली शोन ऑफ पैरेन्काइमा सेल्स. नाउ पैरेन्काइमा सेल्स मीन्स दीज सेल्स और दीज सेल्स ऑफ द यू कैन से इनर मोस्ट वॉल are radially elongated. Okay, parenchyma cells here, they provide nutrition mostly. Okay, and the cells of the innermost wall layer are radially elongated and are also very very rich, very very rich in protoplasmic contents. This layer is known as the inner layer, known as the tapetum. Okay, this is the tapetum layer that I was talking about. Okay, it does what? It specifically, it helps to nourish, to provide nutrients to the pollen grains. Okay, and like I told before only, it has dense protoplasmic contents. Okay, dense cytoplasm. Okay, and they are generally having two nuclei, so they can be called as binucleate also. Okay, they can be called as binucleate also. Okay, or can be multinucleate also. Okay, you can, or they can have a huge nucleus about to divide into multinucleus. I haven't divided, but huge nucleus about to become a multinucleate or divide into multinucleate nuclei. Okay, so their main function is provide nutrition, okay, nourishment to young microspore mother cells. Okay, by either forming a plasmodium, means it forms an amoeboid or invasive type, or it can do it via diffusion, that is known as parietal or secretory type. Two types are there. Okay, in neat examination, both ways, the ways nutrition can be provided. Ways nutrition can be provided by tapetum. There are mainly two ways. You have way of plasmodium. Plasmodium means you have amoeboid or invasive type. Okay, invasive type, or you can go for simple diffusion. Simple diffusion is parietal or secretory type. Parietal or secretory type. It is simple diffusion. Okay. Now what happens is the pollen sac wall encloses a number of archaeosporial cells that further forms, see this in this image, that further forms, you can say, microspore mother cell or microsporocytes. So in the beginning of microspore mother cell formation, so in the beginning what happens, the microspore mother cells are polygonal in structure. They are extremely polygonal in structure and are extremely closely packed. But what happens as the anther enlarges, you can see in this image, as the anther enlarges, the pollen sacs, they become more and more spacious. Okay, and also consequently they become less loosely arranged. So a few microspore mother cells, they become non-functional, okay, and are eventually, you can say, absorbed by the developing microspores. This again happens because a few ones will become eventually non-functional. Now during microsporogenesis, Okay, if you talk about microsporogenesis, what happens is during microsporogenesis, we talk here. Microsporogenesis. Okay. What happens is the nucleus of each MMC, microspore mother cell, the nucleus of each microspore mother cell It will undergo germ cell division, that is meiosis or reductional division, and it will give rise to what? Each nucleus will undergo meiosis here. Okay, they are diploid in nature, will give rise to haploid. Okay, four haploid nuclei, that is known as the microspore tetrad. Four haploid nuclei, that is known as the microspore tetrad. Very, very important first step. Now these four nuclei are not arranged like anything, they are arranged in a tetrahedral manner. Okay, they form a tetrahedral tetrad. Okay, and the four microspores, then they mature. Okay, they will then, followed by that, they'll get dehydrated, they'll lose their excess water, and in the end the tetrad will eventually separate. Whatever tetrad we have been able to form, or the plants are able to form, they'll eventually separate out. Okay, and when they separate out from each other, they'll develop a characteristic shape or form of their own. Okay, which again differs from species to species when it comes to plants. Okay, now if we talk about in detail, first of all, if you talk about the structure of microspore is the pollen grain. Okay, so if you talk about microspore, the pollen grain which bears the microsporangium, the pollen sac, so the pollen grains develop, okay, from the diploid, you can say, microspore mother cells. Okay, in the end it will develop from where? The microspore mother cells in the pollen sacs. So the pollen grains are the, you can say, ultimate, you can say, result, the consequence of this entire microsporogenesis. Because in the pollen sac we say that we have pollen grains, but who was the main constituent, or who was the initiator, where did the inception of all these things happen? So the inception of all these physiological processes, it started in the microsporangium. Okay, so pollen grain, they are present in the pollen sac. Okay, so the pollen sac, they bear pollen grain, not they bear, they give rise to pollen grain. Okay, and then what will happen is, typically the pollen grain is what? What is the ploidy of a pollen grain? The pollen grain are mostly haploid in nature. Okay, they are all haploid. They have one nucleus only, they are all haploid in nature, they are uninucleate. Okay, always remember, they are haploid in nature and they are uninucleate. Okay, and they are generally spherical, measuring only 25 to 50 micrometers. If you talk about a pollen grain, they are generally spherical, measuring only 25 to 50 micrometer. And micrometer what? In diameter. This is not the radius or something, this is the diameter. Okay, double the radius. Okay, now what happens is, this comes in your board examination, that the outer surface of microspores may bear certain spines, ridges or furrows that may again vary from species to species. Okay, there may be oval, you can say ellipsoidal, you can say triangular or lobed or even Christian saved pollen grains present in various species. Okay, but the thing is, the cytoplasm of the pollen grain is surrounded by a two-layered wall. Very, very important. If we talk about pollen grain, the cytoplasm of a pollen grain is surrounded by a two-layered, a double-layered wall. A two-layered wall. Again, the outer layer is known as exine. Okay, outer layer is known as exine, and it is thick. Okay, sometimes it could be smooth, sometimes it could be sculptured also. Okay, so mainly it is thick and smooth, I can say. Thick and smooth. But what happens is, it is cuticularized. It has the protein cutin. Okay. And cutin is what? It is made up of a specialized type of a fatty substance known as, or known by the name which comes mainly in various board examinations and almost in NEET examination also, known as sporopollenin. Okay, you can underline it, known as sporopollenin. Very, very important. One question is, why pollen grain is used as a, you can say, biological fossil fuel, or simply a fossil fuel? Because of sporopollenin. Because sporopollenin is highly, highly resistant to very high temperature. So sporopollenin, if you talk about sporopollenin, fatty substance, is highly resistant to high temperature. Okay. It is just like the spore present in bacteria, or when the spore formation happens in bacteria, in, you can say, fungus. So it is kind of the same. You can just relate the spore formation to sporopollenin, because they also, the spores are also highly resistant to high temperature, pH. Even if you put acid on them, nothing happens. Their metabolic rate also decreases a lot. Okay, so it is again same type. It is highly resistant to high temperature. Even strong acids like H2SO4, H2, then HNO3, HCl, okay, hydrochloric acid, then sulfuric or sulfurous acid, nitrous or nitric acid, HNO2 or HNO3. Okay, so strong acids, then again strong bases, NaOH, MgOH2, doesn't matter. Okay, and also biological decomposition is resistant to all these factors. Biological decomposition. So when it is so resistant to all these things, okay, what happens is, it will not be degraded easily, and it can be used as an exemplar, okay, as a specific sample for fossil fuel also. Okay, and in, especially in insects, various insects, what happens is, there is a specific yellowish, viscous and sticky substance known as yellowish, sticky and viscous substance. This also comes in NEET examination and board both. This is known as pollen kit. Okay. Not in insects. Okay, here insect means insect pollinated, okay, flowers. Okay, so insect pollinated pollen grains, you can say, insect pollinated pollen grains. What you have is the presence of yellowish, sticky and viscous substance known as pollen kit. Okay, so this covers the exine. This covers the exine and pollen grains. And then this pollen kit will help the insect to stick and then transfer, and when the insect will transfer the pollen grain, the pollen grains will be stuck. Okay, the pollen kit, when the insects will then fly off, okay, when the insects will take off, this due to the pollen kit, the pollen will be stuck to the insect for further transmission via cross pollination. That is how it occurs. Okay, so I hope you were able to comprehend the lecture, and if you had any kind of doubts, we will be continuing this lecture, and we will be talking about microsporogenesis and megasporogenesis in detail in the next class, and also if you get time, we will talk about the double fertilization event also. So if you had any doubts, queries, you can contact me on my personal number. I will be replying as soon as possible. Right, Vanshika, you are correct. Okay, spore of pollenin. So thanks a lot. Let's meet you in the next class.